Hi, and welcome to this series of tutorials on the Subtractor Synthesizer. The Subtractor's been with Reason since the beginning of the program's launch. Although it appears to be quite a basic synthesizer, it offers the budding sound designer an opportunity to kind of get into programming synthesis without it being too complex. If you went straight ahead and tried to use the Maelstrom or the Thor within Reason, you'd find that maybe some of the basics would be lost on you, you wouldn't understand it. So we're going to start by just looking at the subtractor. If I right-click and create a subtractor, the device enters here. Now, what you've got is a default bass sound. And when you're programming, you're not going to want that. You're going to want to start from an initialized patch. So if you right-click on the subtractor, you can initialize the patch. Okay. So this just gives us one sawtooth wave up in the oscillator section here. It's important when you start using a synth to, although it may not be immediately obvious where the sound is going, to start to learn, like you do in the studio, how the sound gets from one place to the next. In other words, the routing of the sound. So the routing of the synth or the subtractor starts with the oscillator here. Okay, so this is where your initial sound comes from. Now, there are four basic waveforms that you need to become familiar with when you first start out creating sounds. The first one is the sine wave. Okay, the sine wave is quite a soft, mellow sound. It's quite organ-like, and in fact, church organs are just a succession of sine waves that have been added together in an early type of synthesis called additive synthesis, where you add multiple sine waves to make a more complex sound. In this case, it's on its own. A sine wave on its own is not that powerful a sound. It's okay to use in conjunction with another waveform, or okay to use for sub-bass, because it doesn't have any higher harmonic content, so it doesn't get in the way of your any other waveform you may layer on top of it. It's not a very bright sound. It's a very kind of mellow sound. Okay, and then you go up to the next one, which is a triangular wave. A triangular wave is like a sine wave that's been ironed out. And what they've done is added some odd harmonics to the sound. So it's a little bit brighter than a sine wave, which makes it a little bit more useful for kind of keyboard sounds. It's also quite fluty, really, when you listen to it higher up. The next one is a square wave. The square wave only has odd harmonics, so it's got quite a hollow sound, quite reminiscent of a clarinet or an oboe or a kind of wind instrument, reedy instrument. It's got that kind of reedy sound. If we go to the sawtooth, which we had in there in the beginning, this contains not only the odd harmonics, but also even harmonics. So it has a very bright, brassy sound. Okay, so very good for brassy, bright sounding instruments. Okay. Now, the next thing you come to is your octave. Okay, so this allows you to change octave. Okay, and then semitones in between, so we can tune it in semitones, smallest interval that we use in Western music. And then what we've got is in between the semitones, you have cents. Now, you can adjust 100 cents per semitone, so that means you're going 50 one way and 50 the other way. Okay, you should be able to hear it bending the pitch very slowly. Okay, I'll explain why this is useful in a little bit. It's very good for detuning sounds and making them sound a bit thicker. Okay, coming on to the second oscillator, you have to turn this on, so you need to switch that on. You can now hear that you've got two waveforms coming through. Okay, so that's one, that's two. Okay, so it gets louder and doubles up the sound. Okay, if I drop that one an octave, you can hear it underneath the top one. Okay, same tuning, semitone and cents. Now, if I put them both in the third octave, just going to show you a little trick. If you're into kind of dance music stuff, you might have heard of something called a Reese bassline, or people mentioning a Reese bassline that's invented by a guy from Bristol. This is a way of fattening up the sound to make a nice fat bass. The way you do that is you take your top oscillator and detune it up 7 cents. Take your bottom oscillator. It doesn't really matter how many cents, but it's just got to be detuned, and how much detuning is kind of up to you. This will give you a nice big fat bass sound. Okay, just by detuning those oscillators. You also see that you've got keyboard tracking on here. That means that you can change it so that it doesn't track the keyboard anymore. If you unclick them, it means that every note across the keyboard, you can't see what I'm doing, but I'm playing notes up the keyboard, and they're all the same pitch. Okay, useful if you want to create drum sounds or percussion sounds and you're not worried about it being pitched. Most of the time though, however, it needs to be on keyboard tracking so it follows the pitch of the keyboard. Okay. This is the mix between the two oscillators. Okay, so that's one, that's two. Okay, and you can mix between them. The other things on here we don't need to worry about for the minute. I might come back to them later. Okay. Right, we'll just stop there. That's the end of the first video, and then we'll go on to the filter in the next one.